I was reminded when Gloria was speaking that I too am a child of Miami. I went to the public schools all throughout Miami. I grew up in Miami Beach. I went to the proud graduate of Central Beach Elementary School. Leroy D. Feinberg was my principal at the time. But I'm reminded of what happened to me with the arts there and how an experience when you're very young can guide where you go later in life. I too love music. I love music even to this day. I think if I didn't have a bookshop, I would probably have a music club of some sort. But that doesn't mean I can do anything with it. As my music teacher in elementary school made very clear, I had a music teacher named Mrs. Dunning who taught voice and singing and all of that, and I loved to do it. But I realized that she didn't love me to do it. When one day during parent-teacher night or something like that, she literally told me to lip-sync the words because I was creating too much of a dissonance in the group. But what guided me, I guess, was at the very same time in that very same elementary school, they had this marvelous program which I would love to see instituted again. You know how there's a safety patrol in every school? In our school, we had a library patrol as well, where they identified certain people. Maybe it was because I wasn't a reader enough, or maybe it was that I was a big reader. I can't really remember exactly. But they made me part of the library patrol. And twice a week, I would go to the library. And Mrs. Kravitz was the librarian there. And I remember being in my first book groups as part of that. Organization, and it was one of the most fulfilling things that I can remember doing, other than PE, during elementary school. And so I think from there, hearing you speak, both of you, made me realize that everything that I'm about is really the humanities. And I have been very fortunate to grow up at a time when I grew up mostly going to school in the 60s and early 70s, when the humanities were king and queen. Many of you may remember in those days the Quinmester program, where you could take courses in junior and senior high school as if you were at a college. So I actually got through, I mean, this sounds a little, it doesn't sound terribly rigorous, but I got through my English high school requirements by taking rock poetry and existentialism. I couldn't imagine that happening today without it being demagogued in some real way. I found the Doubleday Bookshop on Lincoln Road, the place where I hung out mostly. It's where I learned. It's when I turned 15, my father said you could go in and buy whatever you want. But again, it was during the 60s, so what did I end up buying? Well, I bought books by Jerry Rubin and Abby Hoffman and Soul on Ice and that sort of thing. But still, books, authors, they were my heroes growing up. And a lot of it had to do with what was happening in my school at the time and the courses that seemed important to me. All of that led me to where I am today, which is really in the private sector. But yet I feel, as a bookseller, I feel an incredible responsibility to the community that I grew up with and into the community in general. And I know that independent booksellers all across the country all feel pretty much the same way I do. Many of us became booksellers, as refugees from something else. I went to law school for a couple of years. I hated it. I had to figure out what I wanted to do. So I hearkened back to the library patrol and became a bookseller. And there were I remember when I was in college in the early 70s, this is pretty remarkable. I happened to go to the University of Colorado only because I had never seen mountains nor snow. I grew up in Miami Beach. I read the Jack Kerouac book and I said, I want to go live on a mountaintop somewhere. So I went out there. And I can tell you, at the University of Colorado in the early 70s, there were 5,000 English majors. And there were probably about 50 business majors at the time. It was a very, very different time. So all 5,000 of those English majors all became independent booksellers. And this is our 30th anniversary, and there are many other booksellers like myself who have made it their mission to carry on literary culture in the communities that they are in. And what they've been able to do, just like what we've been able to do here with Miami-Dade College, with Alina, with Eduardo, and with the vision of the people here, we've been able to forge these partnerships where private businesses, private bookstores, have been able to partner with, in this case, educational institutions, in order to promulgate literary culture. And like you're a historian and you're involved in music, my thing is to be able to have literary culture be identified as one of those arts that needs to be supported. And I think we in Miami have done something that's extremely unique and it's extremely remarkable, that we've been able to, first of all, help sustain an independent bookstore for 30 years, to help a literary festival have its 30th book fair next year. That doesn't happen in very many cities. And certainly no one ever thought it would happen in Miami. When we first started, the publishers were willing to maybe send us somebody who had a non-prescription drug book out. or certainly we could have gotten the Danielle Steele Light. But nobody would have possibly imagined that serious reading and serious literature would go on here in Miami. There are certain things that I just, you know, wanted to just say in terms of this testimony notion of things. I not only sit here as a bookseller, but I also taught high school. I taught high school English at Southridge High School for 3 years before having the bookstore. I taught English. I taught both upper-level English classes, and I taught basic-level English classes. And I saw what the power of reading and the power of books could do in both cases. I also sit here as a parent of three kids, one daughter who went through the IB programs of Sunset and Coral Reef High School, ended up at the University of Florida as an English major, who's now got a job in New York as an English major and not as a bookseller, which is remarkable. She's in business, she's 22. And I have two sons who are 19 who are both proudly enrolled at the University of Miami right now. I also got a master's degree at the University of Miami, so seeing both of you there is very heartening for me as well. But one of the concerns that I have, and one of the concerns that I've had during this last political season that we have, and probably it's been going on now for about 10 or 15 years, is the denigrating of public education. And I think the denigrating of public education is something that is really, really dangerous. If we all believe that the humanities help create a kind of civil society, which I think is something we all believe, we are now beginning, I think, unfortunately, to create a split again. Because with the denigrating of public education, you're finding a flight into the private school system of lots of kids. Lots of kids like myself who grew up in public education, their kids are going to the private schools. And what happens in the private schools is something very different than what happens in the public schools. In the private schools, they don't have to teach to the FCATs, for instance. So they have time to be able to have ceramics classes. They have time to be able to have guitar classes. They have time to be able to have music theory classes, art appreciation classes, writing classes. Those things happen in the private schools. In the public schools, all of that is sort of is frittering away. And it's something that I think we have to make a concerted effort to not let happen. Because I think public education is really the backbone of our democracy. And if we begin to see public education denigrated to such a point where basically it becomes the place where it becomes trade schools, basically, we're going to have real, I believe, ultimate social unrest down the road. So that's another thought that came to me as I sat here. And then lastly, when I read that the preamble to this, that we were looking for 10 solutions that would be helpful, I think just in general that forging public-private partnerships is extremely important and something that should be studied, and it should be something I know that the Knight Foundation has worked on and other groups have worked on. But to be able to use the private sector, who are already doing so many important things to help along these lines, I think a study should be made of what are those successful partnerships that have taken place and how they can be replicated down the road and how they can be helped to be funded down the road as well. There should be book fairs like ours all over the country. We shouldn't have to be, you know, begging for funds. They should be well funded. I've sat on a number of NEA grants, NEA panels, audience development. We should be creating partnerships with publishers to get authors into the schools. That should be part of their contracts. They should go meet with students. We should be doing all kinds of things that help, you know, sort of solidify the arts, humanities, and education in so many different ways that we don't only have to rely on the public sphere, but I think we can also look to the private sphere as well. So I thank you for giving me the opportunity to be part of this. I'm honored to be in this room around this table, and I hope that we can continue this discussion into the future as well.
Thank you, Mitchell.